Good morning. Happy New Year. Good to be with you all. Good to see you. Good to share this time with us. Good to begin the year. Next year, I believe, New Year's will be a Sunday morning. So it's all the better way to start the year. But one of the great things is, you know, who could blame you if over the last couple of years you kind of get this brace me, you know, buckle up kind of attitude towards the new year? But that's why I think it's very important, the message I have for us this morning, about facing life with confidence, because we know the God who loves us and who is able. And that really brings joy and a sense, really, of confidence that is available to the believer. We'll talk more about that. Hi. This one? No, we're not using that one. Thank you, though. That's okay. Hey, so let me give you a few announcements. First of all, Sunday school is running, and they are gathering to start in the upper room. We are glad that we can begin to offer nursery, but we'll need a good crew of folk to help make that available. Because, you know, being a young mom, you know, isn't it great to be able to offer them an hour to be with the Lord and just to have a quiet, confident trust? Always need people who will demonstrate the importance of influencing the rising generation by being Sunday school teachers, youth leaders, other groups like that. And Sarah Marcolino is doing a great job of raising up a team to work with our teens and youth and children. And so you know, give her a call, say, hey, I'll do my part. How can I help? And we'll take those gifts that you have, not put you as a round peg in a square hole or vice versa, but help you to find a spot that works well for you. What's next? Okay, Bob's got the study going. All right, good. Gather for prayer at 6:30 on Mondays, and the Bible study itself on 7. And Romans is one of those most important books to understand for a lot of reasons, and Bob can tell you why. Don't forget, we got coffee hour, by the way, where you can ask Bob about his Bible study or any other of these things that we hear about. Gather with us afterward. The missions committee is gathering funds to help respond to those who have been affected by the rash of tornadoes that have happened in the southeast of our country. And the One Great Hour of Sharing method that the National Association has ensures that every dollar you give goes to help. The overhead is already taken care of, so the money goes. So it's much more efficient than some of the other avenues that might be out there. So encourage you to do that. And then this coming Saturday would be a second Saturday, and so that's time for dinner and a movie. You've got meatloaf and some other good warm comfort foods. Winter will come eventually. And so then, strawberry shortcake. You ever make that before? I don't know. No, okay. Yeah, just wondering. Some people just come for the shortcake and forget about the dinner. Yeah, I hear nods. Yep, I hear them. All right. Good movie, too, The Healer. So come for that. And if you want to be of the happy band that roams in the Sherwood Forest, that is the balcony, Frank would be very happy to train you in some of the tech skills that we have up there. So please help that out. I'm grateful for the town family and others that help out upstairs, but always glad to have a few more. And who knew that it would be a life skill? But handling tech and handling live streams and such like that, you can be very popular with your friends. So that's part of our time. But our purpose, again, is to gather to be in the presence of God, to honor him for his faithfulness through every year that's happened so far, and trust with confidence for the year that's ahead. And so we gather to sing and to praise him, and we're going to start by singing, Arise, Shine, and Glorious. Okay.
Thank you. Is taken from Isaiah chapter 60, selected verses. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you.
For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples. But the Lord will arise upon you, and his glory will appear over you.
Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn.
They come to you. Your sons shall come from far away, and your daughters shall be carried on their nurses' arms.
Then you shall see and be radiant. Your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nations shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense, and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord.
Please be seated.
At as we find ourselves in a time when there are a lot of cases of COVID and other issues, the work we do in prayer is very important. So let us join our hearts to pray according to the concerns and that have been raised and given to us. Join me, please. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for Isaiah's prophecy of gift brought to the one who would be the light of the world. Gifts of frankincense, gifts of gold from Eastern countries. We thank you that no matter how it appears, you are always in control. You are working all things together for the good of those who love you. And we want to be numbered among those who love you because your mercies are great. You are the source of eternal life. Where else can we go? And you are good, and we're glad for that. We thank you for answered prayers, for Roberta Savory coming home and recovering well after hip surgery. We thank you for your grace. We thank you that you are the one who will see us through, that you provide for your children, for those who follow you. You provide. And help us, Lord, to share your good news. Lord, we ask your care on those who need your healing touch, for Rachel with a collapsed lung, Sheila recovering from a fractured vertebrae, for Carter struggling with a limited blood supply to himself and for others, for Tyler, age 7, with ulcers, for Kevin, who's been sick a long time and needs a diagnosis, for 2 children, brother and sister, who need you at work in their lives, that you provide for them, that you give them faith to help them face these challenges they're facing, that you'd especially help their grandmother to recover. Lord, we thank you that we can intercede, though we know not all the issues. We pray that you would be with Mary fighting pancreatic cancer, that you would put your touch upon her and grant healing, and comfort, and assurance. That you'd be with Billy, who's in the ICU with heart issues, and have your strength. We pray, Lord, for all who are fighting COVID, for those who are patients, for Elise, for Sheila. We pray, Carol and I pray for our son Ben. We don't know he's sick and it's got some of the symptoms we don't know yet. And we just pray that you'd touch and heal him, for all who have this, Lord, and for all the different situations where a rash of cases has put some other things in concern. We pray for Cincinnati and their limited fire department right now, and in other situations, that you would put your grace. And we also want to intercede for those who do make public health decisions and those who work in crowded hospitals and other circumstances. We pray for good care to be available to those who are poor and may have limited resources, not only in our country, but around the world. And we ask, Lord, that this might be the time when, after this rush of cases, we find we've gotten to the other side of this. Grant it, we pray. Lord, we ask your comfort to be with all those who are grieving. We remember the friends and family of Bonnie Weil. We ask your comfort on the family of John Chappell. And we also remember Steve Lunetta and all who are mourning the passing of his mother, Eleanor, who will be laid to rest next Monday. Lord, we thank you that you do offer life everlasting to those who trust you. Grant that we take advantage of that now while we still draw breath. We do pray for our country, our world, our neighbors. We ask, Lord, for there to be justice and righteousness in all areas of national leadership. We pray that you might give wisdom, safety, and right doing and right standing to those who enforce the law. We pray that we as citizens, each of us, would be wise, would be faithful, and would conduct ourselves as such belong, as appropriate to the children of God. We ask, Lord, your mercy on all those deployed to foreign fields. And especially we pray for your mercy and grace upon veterans struggling to fit back into society here back in the States. And Lord, would you bless those who reach out and seek to care and help those who've been through so much seeking to defend their country. Please work peace in the troubled areas of our world and help us, wherever we are, to be true peacemakers as befits the children of God. We thank you, and we pray together as Jesus taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we dedicate the offerings we have brought, we've given in different ways, in the baskets in the back, through the QR codes in your pews, just using the website, mailing them in. However you've done it, let's stand and dedicate these gifts. We'll sing now and pray after. To God in the highest, because you are the faithful one who provides for us. We bring you our gifts, offering them to you, to demonstrate that you are our first allegiance. You have primacy. But also, Lord, we ask that you help us in whatever ways that we are made stewards of gifts in our own lives, as a church, giving to other ministries. Help us to conduct ourselves with integrity, to be those who further your purposes, because you want your kingdom to come and your will be done. For Jesus' sake, amen. You may be seated.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, Chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. This is the reason that I, Paul, am a prisoner for Christ Jesus for the sake of you Gentiles. For surely you have already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I wrote above in a few words, a reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. In former generations, this mystery was not made known to humankind, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. That is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and sharers in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel, I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of his power. Although I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of the boundless riches of Christ, and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church, the wisdom of God in its rich variety might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, we're in this curious time of technically Christmas season. If you ever want to keep score of where we are, white pyramids are Easter and Christmas, just in case you wanted to know. We're coming up on Epiphany, though, and next week is that hide Sunday in our church calendar known by the technical term of the switcheroo. It is it's a pulpit exchange between our sister churches and the National Association. And there's a new church in our association. The Congregational Church in Pembroke has recently joined the National Association. Their pastor, David Poole, will be preaching here. I'll travel to Scotland, but I don't need a passport. I'm going to Bridgewater. There's a section of it called Scotland. I'll be preaching there. But so that will actually technically be Epiphany Sunday. We've all heard, I've had an epiphany. Something has been revealed to me. Well, that's what we call when we celebrate the coming of the wise men to the manger, and other times in which Christ is revealed in his full divinity and as the hope of the world. So that's why we've got some We Three Kings Days songs today. And the first one is We Three Kings. Let's stand and sing number 185. Please be seated. I'm prone to tell a lot of stories about my father and to talk about many of the great things. And that tells you something about the affection I had for my dad. But it might convey a lack of respect for the man who was married about half again as long to my mother. My stepfather, Walter Long, he and my mom had 33 years together. Mom was older than my mother. And in fact, he turned 62 about 18 months after he married my mom. And, you know, of course, I thought 62 was real old then. I stand corrected. But my father, having been a school teacher and thus not a participant in Social Security, I was completely surprised to go with Walt and my mom to the college treasury office and find that the Social Security Administration was going to send a nice monthly check to make a dent in my obligations for room, board, tuition, and fees. And some of you are surprised in that, but at least into the 1980s, I don't know when it stopped, Social Security benefits included support for the minor children of retirees, which extended to age 22 if the child remained in school. And though he had married my mother when I was already 18, according to Social Security, Walt was my father. It felt something like a vindication, I'll tell you, because having dealt with a certain level of poverty because of my father's early death, things felt like they were put a little bit right when I had found I had access to this privilege because I had legally a new father. Access to a privilege because of our father. That's the reason I told you the story. And that episode came to mind as I thought about Joseph, who in the eyes of human law became Jesus' father. Michael Card wrote a great song, Joseph's Song, with the lines, "Father, show me where I fit into this plan of yours. How can a man be father to the Son of God? Lord, for all my life I've been a simple carpenter. How can I raise a king? How can I raise a king?" Now, Joseph had to experience some, he had to have experienced some pretty tangled emotions, having to raise and guide a child to whom he must bow. Of course, good parenting always involves putting what is best for one's children and family ahead of personal gain, but still, there had to be confusing times. And one of them is found in our gospel reading for today, Luke 2, 41 to 52. And in that epiphany theme, this is a time when we get a better glimpse of who Jesus is. Luke 2, 41 to 52. "Now, every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up, as usual, for the festival. And when the festival was ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. But his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, 'Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety.' He said to them, 'Why were you searching for me? Did you not know I must be in my father's house?' But they did not understand what he said to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor." There are many insights to gain from this passage. Jesus is 12. When Joseph and Mary walk a day in the family caravan without seeing Jesus, they don't worry about it. Jesus was at the age when a child would rather be with anyone beside his or her own parents. It's not rebellion. It's differentiation. Becoming a person in one's own right. But what comes through this only episode we have about Jesus' growing up period is his deportment. He carries himself, even at 12, with an assurance unknown in adults twice his age, and many of us search for it still. That's the good news of today's message. Jesus offers us the same free and fearless confidence in God that he lived by. It all starts with God. God knows that our human brains are too small to figure him out on our own. This is why a loving God, he revealed himself first in prophets, but ultimately in his son, Jesus of Nazareth, who came as the Word of God written large. The God who is revealed this way is personal, powerful, and loving. He works in the affairs of human beings to guide them to truth and to bring justice so that evil will not always prosper. And even though by the fearful gift of free will, all humans are allowed to perpetrate a certain amount of evil, the divinity who shapes our ends will work all things together for the good of those who love him. Jesus knew this and so lived by a free and fearless confidence. And I want us to live that way. I expect you to too. Well, let's look at this confidence that Jesus showed. You can see that it is rooted in understanding his identity. Jesus knew to whom he belonged. When after 3 days of being apart from them, Jesus sees Joe and Mary come in and ask in what had to be exasperated tones, "Son, why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been in agony searching for you." And as exemplary as Mary must have been in order to be picked for the job of delivery vessel for the Savior of the world, she's lost a little of the assurance that had allowed her to say yes to becoming pregnant with Jesus in the first place. So Jesus offers a twofold correction. The first is the more major. Now, clearly Jesus knew he was the unique Son of God. To him it was obvious where he must be, teaching and clarifying the Word of God. He's been with the official teachers of Judaism, hearing them and asking them questions. Yet the onlookers acclaim Jesus for his answers. Well, which is it? We need to remember that in Hebrew, and the tradition, the cultural tradition, answers are often in the form of a question. Rabbi, why do you always answer my questions with a question? Is there a better way? But in saying that he had to be in the temple, he also offers a mild correction to his mother, who has just said that she and Jesus' father had been searching for him. Jesus says that he is in his father's house. Jesus knew to whom he belonged. He was uniquely the Son of God. He was on a mission. He was obligated to do his father's will to a degree unequaled in human history. As you sang through the verses of We Three Kings, are you struck by how much, like, Holy Week is in there? Myrrh is mine, the bitter perfume, breathes a sigh of gathering gloom, sorrowing, dying. And then, glorious, behold him arise, King and God and sacrifice. He was on a mission from the beginning. Well, in declaring that he had to be in his Father's house, Jesus is making clear his primary submission. Who, first of all and foremost, he is submitted to. Now, so many of human instances of human tragedy are born of misplaced priorities, misplaced allegiance. You know, the boy who robs a store because the gang he wants to join requires it as an initiation. The girl who surrenders her virginity because he says he'll drop her if she doesn't. The young man with a family who either neglects them in pursuit of an unsustainable standard of living or won't put out enough effort to provide adequately for them.
Yeah, and that last one involves walking a fine line. Nobody said this was easy. But if we remember, as Jesus did, that our primary submission must be to God, our Heavenly Father, and to His guidance for us, we will increasingly be able to dismiss the false claims for loyalty in our lives. So whatever happened in Jesus' life, He knew He had to first submit to the will of His Heavenly Father. That was primary submission. Ours is the same. And once God's primacy is established, we then submit to others as Jesus submitted to His earthly parents in accordance with the patterns God has established. He desires parental authority and responsibility. He desires governments so that people may live in peace, safety, and adequate provision. These deserve our submission at a secondary level, one nation under God. By definition, no one hearing me this morning is the unique child of God. But one of the most powerful truths within the good news of Jesus Christ is that to all who received Him, who believed in His name, He gave power to become the children of God. He still does. This is much the same as it was for Jesus. When we keep straight whose we are, who the Father is to whom we owe primary submission, we are well on our way toward that free and fearless confidence that marks the victorious, abundant life that Jesus came to bring us. God often uses those to whom we owe our secondary allegiance as a means of guiding us. Now, as I was writing this, I had to wonder if folk might be getting hung up on that word submission. Might be a little scary. Our culture is filled with the attitude that we are subject to no one. And you'll particularly hear this, ironically, trumpeted by manipulative advertisers. You deserve a break today. I'm worth it. Why do you think it's called the iPhone? Create the illusion of gaining independence by the purchase of your product. That's the advertiser's mantra. While actually enslaving them to you. Zero interest loan, but 60 equal payments are required. They don't tell you in the ad what the fine print says. You can't pay it off early. And if you miss one payment, the whole purchase is on 29% interest, compounded over the 5 years from the beginning. You're going to serve somebody, Bob Dylan said. Instead, the Word of God counsels us to live within our means. You're going to serve someone. Best to serve God who puts His superior wisdom to work for you. You know, professional athletes. I hear there's a game at 1 o'clock. I see a couple of... I can't preach long. I'll lose people. Professional athletes rely on their coaches to help them achieve their goals. The ones who won't be coached wash out quickly. When we make the right decision on to whom our primary submission is due, we become better servants of those who deserve our secondary submission than if we made a god out of them and said we love them more than God Himself. If you allow someone else to so dominate you that you lose yourself in the process, you are not doing the dominator a favor. You're setting him or her up for a really bad day when the judgment comes. If we love God and submit to God first, then when someone, a spouse, an employer, or government official, wants to require something of us that would displease our Lord, it's much better for that person if we say no. But that's not to say we're supposed to be rebellious all the time. If you looked again at verse 51 in our gospel text, it says, "And he went down from Jerusalem with them to Nazareth and continued to live under their authority." When Dad said to sand a board or carry in firewood, Jesus did it. When Mom said to wash the dishes, he did it. When they told him to study for Hebrew school, it probably didn't take him long. But he obeyed. The Christian should be the best employee a company has, because the Christian knows that all he says or she says or does, they do as unto the Lord. When I'm caning a chair for a client, my handwork is a reflection on the Lord whom I say I serve. Christian athletes, Christian celebrities should not be jerks. Christian wait staff takes care of the customer while not letting a dish go cold because they think words of witness will outweigh an obligation to an employer. We can and must be better at our secondary allegiances because of our primary ones. Like Jesus, we must always remember to whom we belong. Now, consider Ephesians 3 that Chris read for us. When I was researching the text for this message, where the New Revised Standard Version translated verse 12 as Jesus, in whom we have access to God and boldness and confidence through faith in him, one scholar put it as free and fearless confidence by means of faith in him. And that just struck me, that phrase. I believe there are many forces in our world that would try to rob us of confidence, would try to give us fear. And the free and fearless kind of confidence is the best kind. So how do we get this free and fearless confidence? Paul says it is promised to us as Christian believers, and he's not writing from a comfy chair in an ivory tower. Paul is a prisoner in jail because he refused to renege on his primary submission to Christ. We've all seen pictures and movies of prisons in these times. Stone, dark, even chains. But Ephesians is not the letter of a broken man. Paul has confidence in spite of adversity. His entire life is colored by free and fearless confidence, that God will hear his prayers and respond with grace, with power, with love. He has this access because he has put his faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Have you? Our call to worship came from the prophet Isaiah. This is one of those verses recommended for the 12 days of Christmas. The reason is most clear in verse 6, where kings come by camelback from eastern countries to bring gold and frankincense. And like I said, it sounds a titch familiar. Wonderful confidence flavors everything Isaiah says here, which is astounding in itself. In his first chapters, Isaiah warned the people that foreign invasion was coming. It's going to be bad, and the Israelites brought it on themselves. But Isaiah also wanted the people to know that the discipline did not signify God was abandoning them. When the days of discipline were done, Isaiah says to his people, when that happens, rise up and be light. Arise, shine, we sang. God's going to bless you. Paul was a zealous student. No doubt he knew this passage from Isaiah, but he certainly lived by it. He was going through a time of discipline himself in prison. Because Paul could not go to the fledgling Christian communities, he had to instruct them by written letter. And if he hadn't written these, we wouldn't have them. 2,000 years of Christian believers are richer because Paul was imprisoned. And in spite of imprisonment, he had confidence. He's seen God do wonderful things and knows God will continue to do so. The present circumstances don't matter. Great things are ahead. So Paul has the confidence of seeing God at work. His is a joyful commission. Now, some of you are already operating in this confidence. Others of you have given your primary obedience to the Lord, have received this gift. This confidence is available to you, but have yet to open it. You know, it's a present that's still under the tree. You got to open it and make it your own. Some of you who are hearing me are exploring faith for the first time. God is offering you the opportunity to live by a free and fearless confidence. Please access this. The first step to doing that is hearing God's offer, as if you were an Ephesian. The promises of God that were originally offered to the children of Israel are available to everyone who will believe. Verse 6 says the Gentiles were now fellow heirs, fellow members of the body of Christ. Now the renown of the Lord was already worldwide. The Jews had a life others wanted. And now the Ephesians are told it's open to them. They could share in the protection and blessing of living in covenant with the Lord of all creation. You can be a partner with God. Confidence comes from knowing that no matter what happens, you'll be okay. Whether we live or we die, you'll be okay. Consider the defensive measures a free country must make against an aggressor nation. Because we, like them, as we go through life, if we're going to live with confidence, we are in the business of threat defense. The first step in military defense is recognition. Plane spotters in Oahu on December 7th, 1941, saw the first Japanese planes coming in and radioed the news to headquarters. Headquarters said, it's probably nothing, and did nothing. Threat defense, what was that? Recognition? You know, is that a fighter jet? Is it a bomber? Is it an airliner? Is it a drone? Knowing what is coming at you begins your defense. For the Christian, weapons fashioned against us may be different. Different threats, different ways of hurting you at cutting away at your confidence. But the theory is the same. The enemy of our souls wants to work discouragement in us. Which weapon will he choose? The loss of a job? Somebody speaking ill of us? The misinterpretation of our actions and motives? If we, like Jesus, will always keep in mind that every believer is a child of the Heavenly Father, the Heavenly King, we can face each threat with unwavering confidence. So the next step after recognizing what it is countermeasures. There are specific defensive weapons designed to neutralize the threat of an aggressor's weapons. The Christian's defense against the weapons of discouragement is truth. Knowing who God is, what he has said, and what he will do. The discouragement is rooted in lies. The truth can be found everywhere. From the book of Proverbs, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. Or you're feeling financial strain, and my God will supply every one of your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And when the threat is against your reputation, remember that no matter what the world may call you, 1 John says, behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us, that we should be called the children of God. You are loved by him. Who you are is a child of God. Soldiers guarding their borders, their nation's borders against aggressors, learn when it's time to call in allies. From time to time, every one of us will face an attack bigger than we can fend off alone. This is why Paul made a big deal of telling the Ephesians that they were fellow members of the body of Christ. We belong to one another. It's hard to find you in the singular in the New Testament. It's almost all plurals. And there's so many one another's. In congregational tradition, we make a covenant to each other to walk together in the ways of the Lord. We are pledged to each other to aid and to help. The hymn, blessed be the tie that binds. We share each other's woes, each other's burdens bear, and often for each other flows a sympathizing tear. Our victory comes when we know when to be relying on outside help. My dear friend Tom Curry serves Victory English Fellowship in Taipei, Taiwan. It's not so much a church for believers from England and the U.S., as for folk from around the world, throughout the Pacific Rim especially, who may not know Mandarin Chinese, but have learned English along the way. And so on Christmas Eve, these are some of them, they sang Silent Night in 6 languages. Right about the time that Tom and his wife Rhonda arrived in Taiwan, the government of mainland China began to ramp up its aggressions against this little island nation. But the believers of Victory English Fellowship have confidence in the face of attack and in the face of adversity. They know that all of us die at some point. But unlike those who seek harm against their neighbor, whether they live or whether they die, they are the Lord's. They live by a free and fearless confidence. Have you hidden yourself under the care of God's hand? Jesus offers us the same free and fearless confidence in God that he lived by and that he demonstrated when he was just 12 years old. So do not fear. Submit to God and trust in his certain grace. Jesus offers us the same free and fearless confidence in God that he lived by. Let us pray. Oh Lord, how grateful we are that you offer to us this victorious life. Not because we deserve it. We each know we don't deserve it. But you love us. Your desire is to restore to you the wandering child. And we've each been that. So, Lord, whether it's for the first time or the 100th, we want to plant our allegiance with you. We come to you with the communion ahead of us, knowing we need to confess to you that we have sinned. The good we have failed to do, the wrong we have done. It's not anyone else's fault but us. And we ask your mercy, your forgiveness. We say, I'm sorry. Sorry that we have failed to recognize that you are the one to whom allegiance is due. And this morning, whether for the first or the 100th time, we make you, Lord, and Lord, also, we say, please forgive us. We say, please come into our lives and take the throne of our hearts. Make us fully thine. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. And God, our hearts are filled with a thank you because you want to do this. You've been waiting for us to ask you in. It's been your idea. You're calling to us. So we say yes, and we praise you and thank you for your great mercy. And ask that you help us every day by the gift of your Spirit at work in us to walk according to your guidance. Lead us, Lord, now and always, for Jesus' sake. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer for the first time, I just invite you to speak to a deacon, to myself. We'd love to help you make good beginnings in this decision. What a time to make it, the beginning of the year. But Phil and Carrie and Skip and others, feel free to talk to them, talk to me, and we'll be happy to just kind of help you secure this new beginning. Let's tend our attention now to the Sacrament of Communion. Remember, you start with the juice down. Trust me. One nice thing about these, you know, we've all had our words about these little packs. But there's something, there's a symbolism you can get out of this. You see, these travel. You can carry these with you. You know, there are folks, thanks to Frank and his team doing the live stream, there are folks who know when they go on vacation, they're going to just come to church on live stream. And they can pack one of these with them. But what we're doing is we're packing an assurance. You know, there's a grace that happens when we share in a sacrament. And so we, the assurance, you know, we ask for it to become the spiritual body and blood of our Lord to reassure us. So, you know, you have this, a reminder that God's grace is always available to you. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for these elements. We thank you that believers around the world, Kenya, Taipei, Guatemala, many other places, are sharing communion today. Many desiring to begin the new year, affirming that they want you to be the food that gives them strength, the liquid that refreshes their thirsty souls. And Lord, we celebrate your forgiveness that comes when we confess our sins. That you so loved the world that you gave your Son, that whoever believes in you would not perish but have everlasting life. And so, God, would you grant that in and through this sacrament, these elements would become channels of grace, your grace, consecrated to your purposes, and that we then might be the same, your vessels, to minister to a wounded, hurting world. Oh Lord, come to us, abide with us, and be known to us in the breaking of the bread for Jesus' sake. Amen. On the night he was betrayed, while he was at supper with his disciples, Jesus took bread. And after he'd given thanks for it, he broke it. And he gave it to them and he said, "This bread is my body, broken for you. Eat this, every one of you, in remembrance of me." Take and eat. After supper, he took the cup and he blessed it and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink it, every one of you, in remembrance of me." In this cup, participate in new life. Take and drink. In early November, we participated, Carol and I participated in worship on live stream with the Taipei church I mentioned. And this prayer of thanksgiving that I put in last month for the first time comes from them. And if, now that you know a little bit about their background, I think it can help you understand the power that is in it. Let's read together our prayer of thanksgiving. Heavenly Father, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown to us, but known to you. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Praise God, and let us stand to sing, As with Gladness, Men of Old. Guide us by your holy light always, that we may live in a free and fearless confidence, because we belong to you. All glory be thine now and forever. Amen.